woman going through divorce and you want to know more about the routes and the options available to you, then this video is for you. I'm Kerry Griffiths. This is the Willowbrook Lifestyle Financial Planning YouTube channel. And today we're going to talk all about collaborative law. I've got along with me a guest today who is Stephanie Bell Chambers from Biscoe's Law. And she is going to tell us and share with us her knowledge. She's the director and head of family law at Biscoe's. And she has a wealth of experience and we're going to pick her brains today. So welcome along, Stephanie. It's wonderful to have you with us. Do you want to start by just telling us a little bit about yourself?
Yes, so as you said, I'm director and family solicitor as well as head of the family department at Biscoe's, a firm based on the south coast of England in Hampshire. And I love my job. I love helping, being able to help people go through one of the toughest stages of their life, whether it's divorce or dealing with children matters. And I think I was quite lucky in that when I was at school, I knew that this was the career I wanted to do. Whereas I know a lot of people still kind of toy with what they want to do when they go to college or university. But I had a 2-week work experience placement when I was at senior school, got to go to court every day.
Wow.
And just thoroughly enjoyed it. So I was just very lucky to think, right, that's what I want to do. That's what I'm going to go out to do. So I did, you know, I went to college, then did law at university and then studied and worked at Biscoe. So I trained as well as qualified at the same time. And stuck there forever. I'm part of the furniture.
Fabulous. I love that. And I love hearing about your background. And I'm really glad that you're going to come along today to talk about collaborative law, because it is something that needs a bit of unpacking. It isn't something that everybody knows a lot about. And it isn't something that you necessarily go into with your eyes wide open. So I really wanted to just start with you just giving us kind of a little bit more about what it is, you know, what is collaborative law, to give us that overview, if that's okay.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think most people have heard of mediation and instructing a solicitor to deal with their divorce, but not many people have heard of specifically collaborative law. And that is a specific process that people have to sign up to during their divorce if they want to use it. So you're signing up to say, we are going to use the collaborative law process, which means that you do not want to go to court and have the court decide your financial situation for you. And the way that that's dealt with is by each client having their own lawyers who must be collaboratively trained lawyers. And then you have 4-way meetings to try and reach an agreement. And once you've reached an agreement, you then convert that into your financial order. And it's just sent into the court for approval. And you tell the court, we've used the collaborative law process. There's a number of advantages of doing so, because you're saving the cost and the time of going to court and using the court process, which is always the biggest advantage for any case. Avoid the court if you can. The other advantage is that you're totally in control. So you decide when those meetings happen. You decide how you want to stage them, so how many you have and what the gap might be in between. And another big advantage, and it's usually where both parties perhaps work or are involved in a family business, mm-hmm. and perhaps you want to try and keep that business going post-divorce, and really you need to be heavily involved in those decisions rather than going through the court process and risking the court making a decision about your business as to whether it should be wound up or one person continue with it on their own and the other person has to leave. So you're just in very much more in control of it.
Those are
really the biggest advantages.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. I would also imagine that an advantage would be that you are dealing with things in the moment and there isn't this correspondence back and forth where things could be misinterpreted. Does that show up?
Yeah, you are very much in the moment because you're all there at the time and you can discuss the things that you want to get discussed during that time that has been set. There can still be correspondence in between, but it would be more limited because you attend those meetings and the focus is to get things dealt with during those meetings. And again, that brings in the cost of it as well. I think it's not very well known or perhaps well used, unfortunately, because I think it can work really well in some cases. But I think there are a lot of reasons for that. I think some people may feel that there's still an imbalance of power. Even though you're there with your lawyer, you're still sat directly in front of your ex-partner or soon-to-be ex-spouse. And you still feel that perhaps there is that imbalance of control and that they perhaps know more about the financial situation than you did. So they can come with all of this information and you may feel under more pressure to agree, knowing full well that you've signed up to this and not to use the court process. So you don't kind of then have that fallback position like you would do outside of the collaborative law process when you perhaps use just your solicitors or mediation. You know that if you still can't agree, you've got the court there that can then make decisions for you. So it's not unfortunately so well known, but for certain cases I think it can work really well.
And what would be the process or the key stages if you were to go down this route? How would it look?
So the first stage is that you need to find a collaborative lawyer, because you've got to have a collaborative lawyer who will do that for you.
And both parties do. Both parties.
Yes, yeah, both parties. And that might be another disadvantage, because you might have been recommended to a firm of solicitors or used a solicitor before that you like. And if they don't have a collaborative lawyer or your normal lawyer isn't one, then you know you may feel that you don't want to then change. So the first process is to find a collaborative lawyer for both parties, obviously different lawyers, you can't have the same one. And then you sign up and you make sure that you understand what you are signing up to, that this is the process you are going to use. You will need to reach an agreement under this process. And then you start to establish the four-way meetings and decide when they will take place and where. So do you use one firm's offices or do you choose somewhere a bit more neutral to go, so you kind of have those discussions up front.
Okay. And is there a general time scale? Is it, or does it all differ depending on the certain clients?
Yeah, it just differs. And that's possibly one of the advantages as well, because you can fit those meetings around your life and what's happening, rather than if you're going through the court process, the court would impose a timetable on you to say, well, everything needs to be done by this date. The first hearing will be on this date. So that's, it just gives a degree of flexibility to all of the parties involved, which again may work around whatever else might be going on in your life in terms of if you're running a business or you want to look at a specific tax year and you want to wait for that tax year to end so you know and you can financially plan moving forward. It gives you that degree of flexibility.
And is this working well virtually? Is this something that's able to happen in the virtual world?
Yeah, it can. It absolutely happens. And everything has gone virtual. Mediation is now virtual. Lawyers are having all of their meetings with their clients virtually because we can't see people face to face. So it's another kind of positive of the pandemic that these things can still happen. I just think it's unfortunate that collaborative law is just kind of less well known at the moment. But there are other processes coming out of court and just generally where the court is taking so long, not just with COVID, but even before COVID, to get a hearing date, it can take so long that there are other ideas that have come forward, like private financial dispute resolution hearings.
Yes.
So you can sign up to have that, and you know, you can sign up to be bound by a particular decision. So there are lots of different ideas coming out of the fact that we are living differently and our ways of life are a bit different. And because we have a court and court system that are so stacked up at the moment, that we need to think about things in different ways and try and save money, because the parties need that money to be able to move forward with. You don't want to be spending it all on legal fees in a court process.
Absolutely. If you are interested in private FDRs, there is a separate video on here. So if you're watching along and you're thinking that might be something you're also interested in, do search through and find that private FDR video, which is really insightful. One thing that I'm really interested in, and I think it's come out here, but be good just to make sure that we have completely unpacked it, is the difference between collaborative law and mediation. Is that something you could just kind of give a little bit of clarity? Because I know that it does confuse quite a lot of people.
Yeah, so mediation is with a qualified mediator, hopefully someone who's had some legal training in their background as well, so they know how the law is applied in the court system. And they normally just sit down with both parties direct, normally. And then both parties have the opportunity to go away back to their lawyers and get advice on it. And nothing that is said at mediation or agreed at mediation is legally binding, and it's all without prejudice. So either party can renege or tweak upon what they potentially discussed or agreed after taking legal advice. But mediation is a prerequisite. So you have to have attempted mediation before going to the court's door, in most cases, unless there's an exemption normally for domestic abuse cases. So it is very different. And again, it has its own advantages, great advantages in terms of cost saving, trying to be a bit more amicable, as against some of its own disadvantages, that it's not legally binding. You can spend all of that time trying to work towards a solution and then still not get there and still have to make an application to the court.
Yeah.
But it's still a great tool.
Just a couple of last ones then for you. We haven't really touched on the cost. And is the cost comparative to mediation? Is it comparative to going to court? Where would it kind of lie in that landscape?
It would definitely be far cheaper than court, which is one of its biggest advantages.
Okay.
I think it's probably slightly more expensive than mediation, because with the mediator, both parties are normally paying kind of half each towards the mediator's fees, unless they can get legal aid to try and get a partial exemption towards those fees. So yeah, cost is an issue as well. But again, you've got to look at each process to see what fits your situation and what is best in your circumstances.
And the options,
And that's all about doing your information gathering up front to decide which process is going to suit you for your divorce.
Yeah.
Because even if collaborative law specifically isn't right for your circumstances, doesn't mean that you then can't work collaboratively with other professionals to help you go through your divorce. So you can still go to mediation and have a mediator help you. We would always recommend that you go and take financial advice from a financial advisor. And some people like to go and get some advice from a divorce coach as well, because the more informed you are, the more information you have, the more confident the client is to then make decisions about their life moving forward. Because talking about, as we did earlier, that kind of imbalance sometimes of power and confidence and knowledge can make people think that they're on the back foot here. Yeah. But the more information you start to gather from other professionals and have that support network around you, the better able you are, I think, to make informed decisions and look at what kind of settlement you need moving forward to then come out the other side. And I think that's what's key. Legal advice, mediation, financial advice, and then if you need additional counselling or a divorce coach, you've got that option there as well.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Stephanie. That's been a really good insight into collaborative law. I'm going to add to the links below your details in case anybody wants to reach out. Stephanie also runs her own YouTube channel. Is it called Family Law and You? Have I made that up? What's it called, Stephanie?
It's our podcast. Yeah, we have a podcast called Family, the Law and You, which is on Spotify, Google, Apple and Amazon.
And I'm going to add the link to that in the description as well, if you want to follow along with that. And thank you very much. I'm sure we'll have you on again soon, Stephanie. You take care.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Take care.